all remember our first. I'm not talking about girls here, but listen to how Ross gets his first online sale and how much he actually spends to do it. Also, Ross talks about how he got a CEO of a big franchise to respond to him within 30 seconds, even after trying to get through the gatekeeper. Also, Ross talks about his first cold calling experience, how he was sweating, he didn't want to do it, and how he ended up breaking through. That and much more. Hi, Jeremy Weisz here. We're here with Ross Gordon. He's founder and CEO of CraftJack, which sold just 1 year after its inception. Just to give you an idea, CraftJack helps contractors grow their businesses and find new clients through lead generation online marketing. And they also help contractors better manage their leads and win more jobs, which they may be coming out with separately in the future. He's also an advisor and investor at Mystery Tackle Box. And fun fact, Ross also played college basketball. Ross, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Jeremy. It's great to be on.
So, Ross, we get a lot of comments from people. They have tons of ideas. They don't know where to start. They may be trying to start a side business with a full-time job, family, debt, bills, all of that. Or they may just have fear that their family and friends, you know, may see the business fail. And I know you're just a great person to talk to about this because you kind of went from that full-time job, transitioned to online marketing, and then into your company. So I'd love for you to talk to us about how do we go from that idea to making that first sale or dollar. And just to start, I know you have sold CraftJack and you're CEO of CraftJack. Tell us before all that, a difficult time that you had getting your first sale and how you got started.
Definitely. It's a great question. Any entrepreneur, the first thing is I have this great idea, but how do I make money from it? That's the key to keeping it going. So for me, before I started CraftJack, I was actually an affiliate marketer. So basically I was selling other people's products, sending leads to them. And when I first started affiliate marketing, the big challenge for me was how do I get my first lead or sale or whatever it is. The first thing I ever did, it was so challenging to get my first sale. I was just learning affiliate marketing. I had read this book called The AdSense Code from Joel Kahn, and that kind of sparked my interest. He his premise is you can do this yourself and you can make all this money online. And I was so excited to do that. So he got me all fired up and I started a blog and I started, you know, learning how to do this. I built a landing page for a website called I Won Games for Cash, which was an affiliate marketing offer. And pretty much the way that that works is they pay you a dollar for every email that you get people to sign up, and people play video games and they make like 10 cents for every 100,000 ads they watch or something. So I was trying to send people to this page to get them to fill out their email address, and I was advertising in AdWords to do that. And first day I set up my campaign and I put in, you know, my $50 budget, and I'm like, all right, time for bed. I'm going to wake up tomorrow morning and I'm going to see a few dozen leads and I'm just going to be rolling in the profit. So I wake up the next morning and turn on my computer, and there's a big fat zero there. No leads. $50 spent, no leads. So, I was like, this is not going to happen.
When did you get your first sale? So tell us how you got your first sale.
Yeah, so it took me at least a few days of losing, you know, $10, $50, whatever it was every day. And people are not filling out this stupid form with just an email address. I thought that, you know, I'd have hundreds of people do it by now. So I realized there must be something wrong with what I'm doing, because otherwise people would be filling it out if there wasn't. So I started to make changes to my landing page. Maybe I thought, okay, I'm not being clear enough. Maybe people don't understand that they can make money if they play these video games. Maybe they don't understand that that's the value that they can get. Or maybe my ad was bidding on the wrong keywords. So I started to make little changes here and there. And one day I woke up and I turned on my affiliate marketing account and there's a sale there. And I was like, yes, I just made a dollar. I spent $50 to do it. I just spent $50 and I made one. I lost $49. But the fact that I had one sale there was awesome. So once I had some kind of data points to work with, it was like, all right, now we're talking. I can work with something. So I pause all the other keywords and I'm like hunkering down on this one. Okay, let's make this one work. And, you know, kept testing that. And eventually we get to the point where we make a little bit of money off of it.
It's always exciting, that first sale, even though, spending $50 to get a dollar, but you know now that you can scale it up somehow and tweak it. What was that story about you got your most pivotal or biggest sale? So we go from that, you know, you made $1.25 to more of where you're at fast forward today.
Yeah, so that's a good question. So, you know, the affiliate marketing world is very small and you're just doing stuff yourself. As I was building CraftJack and we're working with contractors and real businesses that we're having to settle and bring on, that gets a lot more challenging. And for me, the big moment was, before we started CraftJack, it was previously a site called localpainterquotes.com. It was just lead generation for house painters. It was pretty simple. Mm-hmm. And when we started that, we needed to bring on painters to our business. So at first, we're calling all these individual painters, but then I found a franchise, and I'm like, oh, why don't I get the franchise on board? So first I tried, you know, calling them. The gatekeeper wouldn't let me through to anyone who could make the decision. Emailed them, no response. Finally, I look at the CEO, and I find him on Twitter, and I tweet at him, and I said, hey, from my personal account, hey, I'm with Local Painter Quotes. Can we talk to you guys about this? And, you know, 30 seconds later, he responded, yeah, I'd love to hear more about it.
Oh, wow.
And, that kind of connected us and got on the phone with him and explained to him why we're different than some of the bigger companies they were using. And within a couple of days, he's like, let's give it a shot. And we had, all of a sudden, 25 franchises in one day, pretty
wow.
much for us. That was huge for us, and that was the first big sale that I had, and it was like such a relief, you know?
That's amazing, yeah. And that's innovative, you know, that's creative to go to his Twitter. I wouldn't have thought of that.
Well, it's so funny, even now, I use, like, when I'm on American Airlines, I'm delayed, like, on hold, I'll tweet at them, like, 30 seconds later, I'll get a response. So it's funny, you know, it's just kind of going that direction.
That's great. What's now one thing that you'd recommend the audience to do right now to go from their idea to their first sale, from that, you know, that $1.25 sale, and also to the, you know, to the big pivotal sale? What's one thing that audience should do right now?
Yeah, so, you know, a lot of people when they're starting companies, especially if you're like an early stage startup, and you have an idea and you're building on the app, people are always focused on their product, which is a good thing, but they kind of lose sight of how they're going to get their product out there. Especially in the consumer space, if you're doing something consumer and you're building something awesome, that's really cool, but how are people going to find out about you and how are you going to engage them? So those are things you should be thinking about at the same time you're planning your product. Because if you get this awesome product and all of a sudden you're like, crap, there's no one using it, you know, it's just an uphill battle. You need to be thinking about that from the early days. And on the other side, you know, B2B, a lot of B2B is just about, you know, sale. You got to get on the phone and you got to start calling businesses or emailing them or tweeting at CEOs or whatever it is. But you need to start being proactive. I feel like a lot of entrepreneurs think that it's going to just come to them when they build a product, and that's not really how it works.
Yeah, so tell me that story when someone told you you'd be cold calling.
Yeah, so it's hard. A lot of entrepreneurs who don't have sales experience are scared to do that. When I left college, I was interning at a company called InfoTube. It's a small web design firm, and that's the first job I got. I was technically supposed to be like a copywriting intern, but there wasn't really a lot of copywriting work for me to do, so my boss was pretty much like, okay, you're going to have to start doing other stuff around here. So I was like, okay, so it starts with, you know, you're going to do some project management. I was like, okay, that sounds cool. You're going to kind of work with the web designers. Okay, that sounds cool. And you're going to do sales. And I said, excuse me, what was the last one? I caught the project manager. You said sales? He's like, yeah, you're going to do sales. I'm like, I have no sales experience. I'm a terrible cold caller. I'm not confident in myself. I don't think I should be doing sales. And he's like, well, we don't have anything else for you to do, and we need you to do sales. We'll give you some commission on it. So I was terrified. And I remember that the first day I was doing sales, I had listened to him do some calls, and he was like, prep me. It took me a week just to fire myself up to do it. Gives me the yellow pages, and we were, it's funny, we're actually working with home improvement companies redesigning their websites, but puts the yellow pages in front of me, start with the letter P, start working with these companies. I opened up, and I'm sitting there on the phone, staring at the yellow pages, but didn't dial it. I just have the phone, like, ready to dial. Couldn't dial. Hang up the phone, go outside for a walk, gather my composure, come back to the phone, open it back up again. And I couldn't do it. I couldn't make the first call. I stared at the phone book for an hour and a half, and I couldn't force myself to do it. I go back, and I said, look, I can't do sales. Like, I just... So he eventually said to me, what's the worst that's going to happen? Someone says no, and you move on, and you make the next call. Like, what's the big deal? Just do it. So finally, I was like, you're right. And the worst thing that can happen is someone's going to say no to you, and that's the end of it. You don't lose any money, you're not getting sent to jail, you're not getting they're just going to say no to you. So eventually I, you know, mustered up enough courage, and I was super nervous, and I got through it, and the guy said no, and that was it, and I learned my lesson. And ever since then, you know, you get better, the more comfortable you, the more you do it, the more you're comfortable. But you got to take that first step of making that first call. It's scary, but you got to do it.
Yeah, and it's also thinking, what's the worst that can happen, right?
Yeah.
And so
yeah.
That's...
There's nothing bad that can come of it, and there's only good things that can come of it, so you just got to do it. Yeah.
So, Ross, tell us a little bit, some of the software tools you use and think are important for businesses.
Yeah, so we use, there's a few of them that we use all the time. Basecamp is a huge one. I have a remote team. Our CTO is based in California. Our designer's in New York, and we're in Chicago, so we're literally coast to coast. So Basecamp just allows us to collaborate, review design files. I can post projects for everyone to review. It's a great project management tool if you're working remote, and it's very cost effective. The second must-have tool for us is Dropbox. I've actually just upgraded to the paid account. I've been on the free account for a long time, but we're pretty serious Dropbox users now. So we've upgraded to paid, and I mean, there's no easier tool. I've never used a software tool that's as easy to use as Dropbox because it's not even, it's basically files on your computer. I mean,
right.
It's awesome. So it saves us money. It allows us to scale and it allows remote teams to kind of have access to everything.
Yeah, and you were mentioning something interesting earlier that I wanted to bring up, which is, you know, Dropbox, when you go from that free, breaking through that free barrier to the paid barrier, what do you think it was for you that broke through that?
It's funny, so we were using the free version for a long time, and then once I capped out my free space, I went to like Fiverr and I got, you know, you can pay someone $5 and they'll sign up more accounts and you can get all this more free space. And it's like you're doing all these tricks and you're asking friends to sign up and you're getting all this free space, and eventually I'm like, okay, we love the service, it's providing us great value, and like for 100 gigs it's like $10 a month or whatever it is, it's like so cheap, I'm like, what am I doing? I'm like, that's insane, it's just time to pay for this thing, it's so awesome. And it made sense. And plus, I want to support them. I mean, they're a company that we like, and we want them to stay in business. Like, let's support them. But yeah, it's hard. Like, with the freemium business model, sometimes it's like you're anchored at free. And so, breaking out of free, it's like you think you're spending like thousands of dollars, and it's like, you know, $10 a month. Come on. But that's, you know, with freemium, you got to watch out because some people are anchored at free. They're going to do anything they can do to be free.
Right. So, how did they break you out of that? Because then people out there can use that.
Yeah, eventually you see the value in it, and it's not worth, you know, $10 a month. The amount of time I spent trying to recruit people to sign up Dropbox for free to get me more space was a lot more than if I would have just paid, you know, I'm billing out my hours at $100 an hour, whatever it is.
Right.
You know, pay for it many times over by just clicking the button that says pay for $10 a month or whatever it is.
So yeah.
It just doesn't make sense to
just
me.
Create too much value for the person that they can't live without it.
Yeah, exactly. That's right.
So, Ross, tell us where people can reach out to you to thank you, and then I want to hear one story from one of your businesses.
Yeah, so I'm on Twitter, at TallRoss. You can always look at me and get back to people pretty quick. I'm on LinkedIn. You can connect to me as well. As far as a good business story,
this kind of transitions into creating that value, like you were talking with Dropbox. And I know you have a good one for this.
Yeah. So this story that I'm going to tell you is actually from the company that I'm advising. I'm also invested in Mystery Tackle Box. I helped kind of co-found it with one of the founders. And this is all about creating a product that people have to have. They can't live without it. And if you're building a consumer brand or even, you know, a business, a B2B product, you need to create that value because that's going to kind of allow you to meet your competitors. It'll take you to the next space. So for Mystery Tackle Box, it was interesting. We had a guy in our early months who his credit card got declined when we tried to rebill him for his subscription. And what happened was we emailed him saying, sorry, you're not getting the box. Your card was declined.
So tell us about Mystery Tackle Box.
Oh, yeah.
Just a brief.
So Mystery Tackle Box is a service that introduces people to new fishing lures. It's for fishing fanatics, essentially. Fishing is a huge market, $45 billion a year. 40 million anglers in the U.S., so it's a big industry. And we're basically introducing them to new fishing gear. It comes out every year, fishing gear. And so we're giving them a box of 3 to 5 fishing lures every month. Makes a great gift, and it's great for people who love fishing. So
so this guy calls you. Go ahead.
This guy calls us, and he says, guys, I just got your email. I see that you're not sending me a box. I got to have this box. Hold on a second. Well, what's the issue? Your card was declined. You know, we can't just send you a box. Well, there was a problem with my bank. Someone had got my credit card number, and there was fraudulent charges on my card, so they had to turn it off. But I'm going to call my bank right now because I want them to turn it back on so I can have you guys bill me so you can send me the box, and they can turn it back off. And so we said, well, are you sure that's a safe idea? If your credit card has been compromised, do you want to be risking credit card fraud just to get a box from us? And the guy's like, Yes, I do. I have to have this box, so I'm going to do that. Give me 10 minutes. And so we did. He called his credit card company. They billed him the 15 bucks, and he turned it back off. And, like, he needed his mystery tackle box that badly. He was willing to risk financial ruin to get a box of fishing lures. So, that was good validation for that company that they were building something awesome.
Great. Well, Ross, I really appreciate your time. I know I got a lot out of this. I know the audience did too. So if you did, please reach out. Thank Ross. And Ross, thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys. Take care. Yeah. See you later, Jeremy.